the European Commission is now focusing more on the lack of rule of law in some member states and is drafting currently a rule of law mechanism inspired by the developments in Hungary and Romania. You were a very popular Minister of Justice before Romania's accession to the EU and have a lot of experience in that area. How do you think this idea of the Commission would work? Do you think it will address the problems that some of the new member states experience?
Yes, I'm very much in favor of a mechanism to sanction the violations of the rule of law in the member states. And the examples used by Commissioner Reding, who is the initiator of this rule of law mechanism, the examples refer to France against Roma in 2010, then Hungarian problems with the constitution and other legislation, and the Romanian, let's say, parliamentary coup d'etat in the summer of 2012, which was a continuous break of the rule of law. So yes, we see that there are such breaches of the rule of law in some member states, and in addition to telephones, letters, questions, statements, we should have a mechanism. I'm definitely in favor of such a mechanism.
And what do you expect this mechanism should do?
Well, for the time being, it has to start with a formal notification from the Commission to the member state. And then Commissioner Reding thought of amending the treaty. Now there are other ways. You can start an infringement procedure if there is a legal ground in the treaty. But if not, then I would go as far as, you know, suspend some of the rights of the member state in the European Union. We have now Article 7, which allows this, but it's so complicated, the procedure is so complicated that it's really almost impossible to do it. So we have to simplify the procedures for this.
So it should be some kind of financial sanctions, or what kind of sanctions?
Article 7 refers to suspension of the rights, of some of the rights of the member states, and that could be also the right to vote in the council, for instance.
So you are more for treaty changes that can simplify the Article 7 procedure?
That's one way to do it, yes. Well, I'm for any form of trying to bring back to rule of law the member state. And, you know, we were successful to a certain extent. If we saw also what happened with Croatia now at the accession in the case of Perković.
Yes, I will ask you about Croatia a bit later. In this regard, what is your evaluation of the CVM that covers Bulgaria and Romania?
I have constantly stated that I'm very happy that cooperation and verification mechanism exists for Romania and Bulgaria for more reasons. It gave a political basis and a technical basis for those few politicians who supported the fight against corruption after the accession. And also the mechanism stopped the politicians who wanted to dismantle basically the anti-corruption institutions, agencies. I'm sure that without this mechanism, the Romanian Anti-Corruption Directorate would not exist any longer today, or the National Integrity Agency and so on.
Yes,
so it's useful to keep the fight against corruption even after accession.
Yes, but there's a lot of criticism that actually this mechanism is toothless. Do you agree?
No, I don't agree. As I said, without this mechanism, we wouldn't have today these anti-corruption institutions. And I have to say that these two institutions, one is criminal investigation, the other one administrative investigation. In the first case, the prosecutors sent to trial politicians from all parties, including parties in power, for corruption, fraud, including with European funds, money laundering and so on. So really work very well, and this is why it's a coalition of politicians to get rid of this, as it happened in other countries as well. So no, it's very good, it's important, it comes twice a year, it's a lot of public debate around it. And in addition to this, we did that other member states look at the CVM reports when they take other decisions related to Romania or Bulgaria. Because
okay, but in the same time, the CVM has not achieved its goals, its initial goal.
It did. Its initial goal, I tell you, because I took part in establishing it. Its goal was to prevent stopping continuation of the reform in the justice system and the fight against corruption after the accession.
Do you think it should be expanded to cover more areas that popped up, like, you know, sick areas still unreformed?
I don't think we have to. It's good it concentrates on these two things, which are really vital for a democracy. If justice doesn't work, then nothing would work in that country. And justice is also to punish the politicians, not only the ordinary people. So I wouldn't expand it. It covers the most vital area. And this is why many politicians try to replace the prosecutor, to change the powers of the institutions. If you listen to discussions in Romania, you hear from the those in power, mainly the socialists and the liberals, that we need to eliminate the conflict of interest, the incompatibilities. Then 2 weeks ago it was an attempt, a successful attempt to change the head chief prosecutors of anti-corruption section. So.
Okay, Vice President Reding told me recently that the areas the CVM covers are something separate, and at this stage the Commission does not envisage the new rule of law mechanism to replace the CVM. Do you think...
Very good. That's very good.
That's good. Okay, so you don't think that the two mechanisms should be integrated in some way?
No. CVM was adopted for Romania and Bulgaria with a specific aim. It reached its aim. It must stay there until the problems are solved in an irreversible way. Now, having a rule of law mechanism for all the member states, or having a corruption reporting mechanism, as we have for all the member states, that's different. It's in parallel. It's not replacing the CVM.
Okay, you were one of the few MEPs who wanted Croatia to end up with a CVM just like Bulgaria and Romania. Do you still believe it had to, especially after the Lex Perković conflict?
Yes, first of all, I wanted Croatia to have a mechanism not necessarily similar to the CVM, not called CVM, but a mechanism to ensure that after accession, judicial reforms and the fight against corruption, organized crime and money laundering will continue. As I said in the Committee for Foreign Affairs, it's written in the stars that these reforms will not continue. And at the time of the accession, Croatia was not even as prepared as Romania and Bulgaria were in 2007. The conflict of interest center, for instance, in Croatia was not yet operational. How do we know it will work or not? What's wrong to have a mechanism and look at this center for conflict of interest and follow its work and its results? And so on. Also, not many convictions from all parties showing independent investigation. And many other things. I think the declaration of assets of judges and all politicians and civil servants are still not published. So there were reasons to have such a mechanism. And I'd like to mention something. Our countries did not join EU for the benefit of the politicians, but for the benefit of the people. And I'm sure that the people would like to have these reforms continuing after accession, because this is the risk, that after accession politicians would stop. Why? Because politicians do not like to be investigated, do not want to have their assets confiscated, do not want to be found in conflict of interest, do not want to lose their jobs. And they can do it because they have the power in their hands. So you need an instrument to counterbalance this wish of politicians. And I'll give you some examples. In Slovenia, for instance, after accession of Slovenia in 2004, there were more attempts to dismantle the anti-corruption agency. The last one was in January 2013, when the head of the anti-corruption agency came out in public and he accused both the prime minister and the head of the opposition of some criminal activities. And the response from political class was that they wanted to replace him. People took the streets. The same in Lithuania many years ago. The parliament wanted to dismiss the chief prosecutor of the anti-corruption prosecutor office after accession of Lithuania. So politicians have this reaction. That's why I'm saying that as long as we know that it's a political decision to join the European Union and these reforms are not irreversible, we cannot do in 10 years what other countries did in hundreds of years, then we should take some safety measures to ensure that this continue.
So you think that that rule of law mechanism the Commission is preparing should or could do some of the job?
It could be do some of the job. However, I believe that any enlargement should come with such a mechanism on the specific problems which are the most severe in that country to the benefit of the country and of its citizens, I repeat.
I was just about to ask you about this. Now with the experience from 2004 and 2007 and 2013 enlargement, do you think something needs to radically change in the accession process?
Yes and no, because I am for accession and I supported the Croatia's accession and I support the accession of Moldova, of the Western Balkans. So I'm for accession. At the same time, the accession process in itself, it's a process in which the country is changed. The economy, yes, you move to the market economy, the situation of the human rights, the situation in prison, the justice system, the administration, the police, the health, the education. So basically all the country changes. And we have to admit that realistically speaking, you cannot ask a country to make all these changes in an irreversible way in 10 or 20 years. So that's why I'm saying that each enlargement should come with a mechanism. Again, to make sure that in that country the reforms continue and also to make sure that we don't destroy the European Union coming unprepared and imposing bad rules.
Yeah, right. Okay, we don't have much more time, so one final question. Now with the death of the EPP leader, when do you think the EPP will start electing a new leader and maybe start discussing nominations for the European Commission president seat?
We'll have elections for the president of the European People's Party probably after the European elections. That's not the time to do elections for the party. And we have President Dole, who is also the president of the EPP group in the parliament, ensuring the interim position.
In Bulgaria, for instance, there was a heavy criticism for the EPP, especially because they supported a government by a sister party in Bulgaria, former Prime Minister Boyko Borisov, who was one of the people that actually violated some of the most fundamental European values. Do you think the EPP should reconsider its policy of supporting governments, even if they are of the own party?
Okay, now you made a statement related to Bulgaria. I didn't ask a question. I don't know which violation you refer to. However, I will give a general answer. Yes, I agree that we should reconsider our position to some sister parties. Based, of course, on the values and principles, and not only on those on the paper, but seeing what happens in reality. Action is important. The facts are important.
Yes, it's not only Bulgaria for that matter, it's Hungary as well, as far as I know. Many countries where they're right-wing or left-wing, it's the same for the Party of European Socialists.
Yes, don't tell me this. I see that every day, yes.
Yeah, because
but in Hungary, for instance, the problems were soft. I mean, the Prime Minister made steps back and the government.
Yeah.
Which also proved that the Commission's role was important.
Yeah.
But what happened in the Parliament to have a political debate against the socialist, you know, between the socialist and the right wing, and to involve all of us.